Myself, Dr. Ritu Verma, and in this session, we will be discussing the anesthesia for ophthalmic surgery. In this session, I have taken the two cases. The first case is 25-year-old male, and he is having the chief complaints of right eye redness, right eye pain, and the diminution of the vision in the right eye for the last 2 years. And coming to the history of the present illness, he is presented to the emergency department with the history of the fall from the bike. There was no history of loss of consciousness and no history of the ENT bleed. On local examination, what you can find in this case, there may be corneal or scleral laceration, volume loss, uveal prolapse, peak pupil or eccentric pupil, teardrop pupil, subconjunctival hemorrhage. And in this case, it is very important to check for the visual acuity. So first thing is to check the vision by checking the Snellen chart. And second thing, if he's not able to read the Snellen chart, you can ask him to assess the visual acuity by asking him to count the fingers. And if he's not able to count the fingers, then you can ask him to assess the hand motion or the light perception. There is another thing, relative efferent pupillary defect, which is usually done to check the optic nerve pathway. And so on the basis of all these things, we can make the diagnosis of the open globe injury. So one thing is very important to know, what is pupillary light reflex pathway? Basically, when the light is shine in any eye, so what happens, the pupil of that eye is constricted. So that is the direct pupillary light reflex. Or there is other part of this, that is the indirect pupillary light reflex. In this, what happened? जब हम light show करते हैं left eye में, तो other eye में भी pupillary constriction होता है साथ में. That is the indirect or the consensual light reflex, pupillary light reflex. So what is the pathway? So it is carried from the retinal cell layer to through optic nerve, through the optic chiasma to the pretectal nucleus of the midbrain, and from here the fibers are sent bilaterally to the Edinger vascular nucleus of the midbrain. From here, the efferent pulses are carried through third nerve to the ciliary ganglion. And from here, the sense impulses are carried to the retinal iris sphincter pupillary muscles. So this is the pupillary light reflex pathway. So you should know, then examiner can ask you it any time. So what is the relative efferent pupillary defect? Basically, it has been done to check if there is any defect in the efferent pathway, if there is any defect here. So what is done in this pathway? What is done in this test? Actually, so what is done, jab hum kisi ki check karte hai, is in the dark room. So what we will see like that, this is a, there will be a dilatation on the eye. So what happened, suppose in this, there is a defect in the left efferent pathway. So when light is shown in the left eye, what will happen? Pupil will either not constrict, or if it constrict, not fully. And when we move the torch to the other eye, like in the right eye, which is a normal eye, so what will happen? It will constrict fully. So here is a defect in the left eye. But what happened in other eye? Same reflex will be, same response will be happen because of the consensual reflex or the indirect reflex. I mean, right mein jo response aayega, wahi left mein aayega, aur jo left mein aayega, wahi right mein aayega, hai na? लेकिन जिसमें डिफेक्ट होगा जिस आई में, उसमें या तो प्रॉपर कॉन्स्ट्रिक्शन नहीं होगा या फिर सिर्फ डायलेटेशन ही होगा. दैट इज द रिलेटिव एफरेंट प्यूपिलर डिफेक्ट. ये हम चेक करते हैं इंटीग्रिटी को चेक करने के लिए, कहीं ऑप्टिक नर्व में कोई डैमेज तो नहीं हो गया, पाथवे में कोई डैमेज तो नहीं होगा. बेसिकली दिस इज डन फॉर दैट. सो कमिंग टू द प्री ऑपरेटिव असेसमेंट ऑफ दीज पेशेंट, सो सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट चीज होती है इसमें असेस करना आपको कि पेशेंट को कोई एसोसिएटेड ऑर्बिटल और मैक्सिलोफेशियल ट्रॉमा तो नहीं है. तो एक सिनेरियो अलग ही बन जाता है, तो वहां पे आपका इतने भी में भी डिफिकल्ट इंटुबेशन, सर्वाइकल ट्रॉमा का पेशेंट नहीं है तो आपको मिल्स करना पड़ सकता है, दैट इज अदर थिंग. तो सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट चीज, फर्स्ट जब भी ऐसी इंजरीज होती हैं, रोड साइड ट्रैफिक एक्सीडेंट, तो फर्स्ट थिंग इज टू असेस द एनी अदर एसोसिएटेड इंजरीज. एंड सेकेंड थिंग इज द टाइमिंग ऑफ द लास्ट ओरल इनटेक. जैसे कि इस पेशेंट में द लास्ट ही हैज फॉलन 2 आवर्स बैक ओनली, तो मे बी ही मे हैव शॉर्ट फास्टिंग टाइम, तो वी हैव टू थिंक ऑन दैट. सेकेंड अदर थिंग इज टू, अदर थिंग्स आर सेम एज इन अदर पेशेंट्स, लाइक स्टैंडर्ड प्री ऑपरेटिव वैल्यूएशन, एयरवे एग्जामिनेशन, द सिस्टमिक एग्जामिनेशन. सो इन दिस केस, व्हाट इज द गोल ऑफ द ऑप्थाल्मिक इंटरवेंशन? सो फर्स्ट इज द, व्हाट द ऑप्थाल्मोलॉजिस्ट वांट, ही वांट्स टू क्लोज इट as early as possible, ideally within 24 hours injury, to prevent any worsening of the eye injury. And second thing, the antibiotic treatment to prevent the endophthalmitis. Because endophthalmitis बहुत ही common होती है. Usually जो भी open eye injury होती है उसमें सबसे पहले यही होता है कि give antibiotics to prevent the endophthalmitis. और एक चीज बहुत important, tetanus prophylaxis की भी history बहुत important है. अगर unknown है या फिर last greater than 5 years की history है तो tetanus prophylaxis भी आपको देनी है. And what are the goals of anesthesia? So first goal of anesthesia in this patient to avoid any rise in the intraocular pressure. And second thing, I have mentioned here to prevent the pulmonary aspiration because its short fasting time may happen. So to prevent the pulmonary aspiration is also very important. There are two goals, to avoid any rise in the intraocular pressure and to prevent the pulmonary aspiration. So coming to what is intraocular pressure? Basically, normal intraocular pressure is about 16 plus minus 5 millimeter of mercury. And when we say it is pathological, if it is greater than 25, it means it is pathological. And do you know that squeezing of the eyelid increases the intraocular pressure by 10 millimeter of mercury, and forceful lid closure increases the intraocular pressure more than 70 millimeter of mercury. I have mentioned this because sometimes the regional anesthesia is given in some patients. And what happened? जब हम ब्लॉक लगाते हैं, अगर हमने ऑर्बिकुलरिस और आई मसल को ब्लॉक नहीं किया जो कि फेशियल नर्व से सप्लाई होती है, तो क्या होगा, पेशेंट जो है स्क्वीज करेगा, फोर्सफुल लिड क्लोजर करेगा, उससे क्या होगा कि इंटॉक प्रेशर बढ़ जाएगा, जो कि हम वी डोंट वांट. व्हाई वी डोंट वांट? बिकॉज व्हाट हैपन, जब इंटॉक प्रेशर बढ़ता है तो क्या होता है, देयर मे बी एक्सपल्शन ऑफ द इंट्राओक्युलर कंटेंट. सो इसीलिए हम इंटॉक प्रेशर को बढ़ना नहीं चाहते हैं कि जिससे कि एक्सपल्शन ऑफ इंट्राओक्युलर कंटेंट्स ना हो. सो दैट्स व्हाई आई हैव मेंशन दीस थिंग्स. So what regulates the intraocular pressure? Aqueous fluid and the choroidal blood volume. So कहीं पे भी अगर impairment of aqueous drainage at any point, so that can lead to the rise in the intraocular pressure. Or second thing होती है choroidal blood volume. अगर वो congestion हो रहा है कहीं पे because the rise of CVP drainage आपका affected है, then what will happen? There will be the rise in the intraocular pressure. Hypercapnia भी आपका जो है vasodilatation कराता है, then it will cause the choroidal congestion and it will lead to rise in the intraocular pressure. और चीज क्या important है, coughing, straining और vomiting, ये भी आपका बहुत ज्यादा intraocular pressure बढ़ाते हैं, तो you have to keep this thing all in mind. So what are the factors which can affect the intraocular pressure? सबसे important चीज होती है central venous pressure, जो कि सबसे important है, सबसे ज्यादा rise इसी से होता है. If it is increased, there will be a too much rise in the intraocular pressure. Arterial blood pressure increase कर रहा है, then intraocular pressure will rise. PaCO2, hypercapnia हो रहा है, hypoventilation हो रहा है, it means कि intraocular pressure बढ़ जाएगा आपका. Hypoxemia हो रहा है, decrease हो रहा है PO2, then भी आपका intraocular pressure will increase. So type of anesthesia, usually ophthalmic surgery तो regional anesthesia में conduct किए, तो why do we want to give any other anesthesia? I am discussing here. So we have two modes of anesthesia. We can plan regional anesthesia or the general anesthesia. Regional anesthesia is very good. It can provide the post-operative analgesia. It can decrease the incidence of the post-operative nausea and vomiting, and also quicker discharge will be there. But why we want to avoid the regional anesthesia in this patient? So what I have discussed, regional anesthesia can lead to rise in the intraocular pressure. So, जो कि हम नहीं चाहते हैं, क्योंकि क्या होगा, when intraocular pressure will rise, there will be the expulsion of the intraocular content. Second thing क्या है कि आपकी anatomy may be distorted. Anatomy में भी तो difficulty हो सकती है regional anesthesia देने में. And what can happen? Uncooperative patient, or trauma का patient, तो he may be uncooperative. So it may be difficult to give the regional anesthesia. So in these cases, usually general anesthesia is given. So our plan of anesthesia is to give the general anesthesia in this patient. So how do we manage these patients? So as I discussed, we have to prevent the rise in the intraocular pressure. And second thing is to prevent the pulmonary aspiration, because he may have the short fasting time and surgery is to be conducted on the emergency basis as early as possible. So maybe he may have full stomach. So सबसे important चीज क्या है इसमें, हमारी planning होगी इसमें कि general anesthesia with the rapid sequence induction. तो फर्स्ट थिंग हम क्या करेंगे, जैसे हमको प्लान करना है तो एस्पिरेशन प्रोफाइलेक्सिस, मेटोक्लोप्रोमाइड 10 mg, रैंटेक 50 mg, और वी कैन आल्सो गिव द नॉन पार्टिकुलेट एंटासिड विद इन 30 to 60 मिनट्स ऑफ द बिगनिंग ऑफ द सर्जरी. मॉनिटरिंग स्टैंडर्ड एएसए मॉनिटर्स ऑक्सीजनेशन वेंटिलेशन सर्कुलेशन एंड टेम्परेचर यू हैव टू पुट प्री मेडिकेशन में आईवी मिडाजोलाम कैन बी गिवन इट हैज नो इफेक्ट ऑन द इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर 1-2 mg कैन बी गिवन सेफली इन सम स्टडीज इट हैज आल्सो मेंशन कि डेक्सम कैन आल्सो बी गिवन ओवर द 10 मिनट्स इट हैज आल्सो शोन टू डिक्रीज द इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर इट वाज गिवन बिफोर द सक्सेनिल कोलिन प्री ऑक्सीजनेशन में यू हैव टू कीप माइंड Face mask should not encroach on the eyes. It can also, any pressure on the eye can also increase the intraocular pressure. And for the induction of the anesthesia, fentanyl, 1-2 mg/kg can be given. It has usually no effect on the intraocular pressure. And propofol, any thiopentone can also be given. Etomidate can also be given, depends on the patient condition. So all these intravenous anesthetic agents usually decrease the intraocular pressure. So एक्सेप्ट द कीटामिन कीटामिन में बहुत कॉन्ट्रोवर्सी है कुछ कहते हैं कि इट विल इंक्रीज और देयर विल बी नो इफेक्ट बट वी विल गो विद द प्रोपोफॉल और थायपेंटोन प्रोपोफॉल इज द गुड चॉइस सेकंड थिंग इज द न्यूरोमस्कुलर ब्लॉकिंग एजेंट अब द रैपिड सीक्वेंस इंडक्शन इज प्लांट डेफिनेटली वी विल गो द गिव द सक्सेनिल कोलिन बट व्हाट इज द प्रॉब्लम विद द सक्सेनिल कोलिन इट विल इंक्रीज द इंट्राक्यूलर प्रेशर हाउ मच इंट्रावीनस सक्सेनिल कोलिन causes the intraocular pressure to rise by the 60 to 12 millimeter of mercury. And this lasts for 15 to 10 minutes. So what can we give other to it? Other than it, non-depolarizing neuromuscular blocking agent, like Becuronium, Rocuronium. So inka jo hai, there's no effect on the intraocular pressure. But Rocuronium can give, you can achieve the good intubating condition within 1 to 1.5 minutes. But what is the problem? डिफिकल्ट एयर वे है तो एज वी डोंट हैव सुगामा डेक्स इन अवर कंट्री सो वी कांट गो विद रोक्यूरोनियम वी हैव इन द डिफिकल्ट एयर वे और अनदर थिंग इज द प्री मैच्योर अटेम्प्ट लैरिंजोस्कोपी एंड इंटुबेशन क्योंकि समटाइम इट मे हैपन एंड यू एंड द पेशेंट मे हैव कफ एंड स्ट्रेनिंग एंड इट विल अगेन लीड टू राइज इन द इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर सो यू हैव टू बी वेरी कॉशियस इन दिस पेशेंट्स अनदर थिंग इज द वॉट वी वॉन्ट टू यूज वीडियो लैरिंजोस्कोप और द डायरेक्ट लैरिंजोस्कोप It has been found in various studies that video laryngoscope has led to less rise in the intraocular pressure as compared to the direct laryngoscopy. So if you are not versed with a video laryngoscopy, go with a direct laryngoscopy. If you are versed with video laryngoscopy, then you can go safely with the video laryngoscopy. Maintenance of anesthesia, inhalation anesthesia has been found to decrease the intraocular pressure and this is dose dependent. Mechanism is a decreased production and an increasing outflow of the aqueous humor, decreased extraocular tension and lowering the arterial blood pressure. Teva can also be used safely, hai na? Extubation mein, phir aapko wohi avoid karna coughing, rashing, vomiting after extubation, kyunki maximum jo increase hota hai, it has been found ki intraocular pressure ka during laryngoscopy, intubation and at the time of the extubation hota hai. And you can also give to prevent the vomiting, Antiemetic agents, ondansetron 5 mg and dexamethasone 5 mg. So take home message is basically what I have taken from the Miller. So succinyl choline may be used to facilitate the endotracheal intubation, the open eye agent, despite its effect on the intraocular pressure. Agar kahin bhi aapko lagta hai ki difficult airway hai and rocuronium you don't want to use, so you can go safely with the succinyl choline. Because first thing is to save the life of the patient rather than the eye. And second thing is the most significant rise in the intraocular pressure during general anesthesia occurs at the laryngoscopy and the emergence. And it is even greater with the repeat laryngoscopy. So second, jo sabse important cheez hai laryngoscopy, intubation, emergence or repeat laryngoscopy. So ye hume avoid karni hai basically. Succinyl choline can be used if you want to use. Aur sabse important, and another thing is avoid coughing. Again, I am repeating crying, bucking or straining. And IV lidocaine 1-2 mg/kg can be given before intubation and extubation to decrease the hemodynamic stress response or avoid mass pressure, hypercarbia, hypoxia and the elevated blood pressure. So main thing is the rapid sequence induction aapko karna hota hai, toh, whether to use succinyl choline or not, what I have got from Miller, you can go safely with the succinyl choline. Any comments from any expert? Before proceeding to the second case. Okay. Now moving to the second case. So this is a 3-year-old male. His chief complaint, as given by his parents, outward division of the right eye since 10 months of the age. And what are the history of the present illness? History of the, you have to basically ask whether he has been having the history of the intermittency or it is constant, and history of the double vision. Past history is very important to identify the cause of the strabismus, whether it is congenital or the acquired, and history of ocular trauma, birth history, low birth weight, premature delivery, crying immediately after birth, jaundice, sepsis, pneumonia, history of sinusitic spells to rule out any congenital heart disease, CNS infection like meningitis, encephalitis, influenza, measles, muscle weakness. The patient sometimes may have dystrophy or the cerebral palsy. History of delayed development milestone, so patient may have cerebral palsy. Anesthetic exposure in the past, like thi, agar koi patient ko bachche ne pehle koi treatment diya hai, anesthetic exposure hua hai. So if something suggestive of the malignant hyperthermia or Meister's spell or any previous treatment for that primary disease. Family history is very important. If the in his family there is somebody having the similar complaints in the family, or agar kuch kisi ko malignant hyperthermia ki agar history hai, to that is very important to take in these patients. So examination mein, as general examination we done in the pediatric patient, systemic examination focusing on more on the cardiac, basically these patients may have some cardiac disease also. Airway examination is very important, may difficult intubation or difficult bag and mask ventilation ho sakta hai, because these diseases are squint is usually associated with some syndromes. Local examination, abnormal head posture, eyelid position, ptosis to nahi hai, third nerve palsy to nahi hai, extraocular movement to check the all the nerves. Visual acuity test in the bachcho mein, adults mein to SNRLs hota hai, bachcho mein different charts hote hain, Allen chart wagaira. Pupillary reflex, as I discussed previously, and the corneal reflex test, that is also known as the Hirschberg test, and the cover test and the uncover test. So corneal light reflex, how it is done, basically the light is shined into the patient's eye from a distance, and we see the reflection of the light in his pupils. So it should be symmetric and in the both eyes, and it should be centered in the pupil. But what happened if the patient is having some esotropia or the exotropia? So as we can see in this figure, the patient is having the reflection away from the pupil and it is towards the nasal side. The eyes move towards the nasal side. This is esotropia. In this, the light reflection is away from the away from the pupil, and this is exotropia, and the eye which is normal has the reflection in the center of the pupil. That is the corneal light reflex to identify the strabismus. So there is other test, cover or uncover test hota hai. That is, cover test is sometimes to identify, like in this we ask the patient to visually fixate a target, and then what we done, we cover his eye and see the movement in the other eye. So the test has to be repeated in the each eye. Agar humne ek ko cover kar diya eye ko, then we see the movement. To agar ye eye fir se realign karne ki koshish karti hai koi bhi, that means it is defective, hai na. Fir se isko card laga ke patient ko kahenge visually fixate a target aur is eye ko cover karenge aur fir isme dekhenge. Agar ye eye waise koi movement nahi hota, it means it normal. Agar ye refixate karne ki koshish karti hai, then it is abnormal. To jo bhi eye कवर करेंगे, एंड अदर आई विल सी कि अगर वो रिफिक्सेट करने की कोशिश कर रही है कि नहीं कर, दैट इज कवर टेस्ट. तो यूजली कवर टेस्ट अगर डायग्नोस डिटेक्ट कर लेता है कि इट इज स्ट्रैबिस्मस, देन देयर इज नो नीड टू डू द कवर एंड कवर टेस्ट. समटाइम्स व्हाट हैपन कि कवर टेस्ट में नहीं कोई स्ट्रैबिस्मस नहीं आता है, देन वी गो फॉर द कवर एंड कवर टेस्ट. अगर कवर टेस्ट में ही आ रहा है तो देन देयर इज नो नीड टू डू द कवर एंड कवर टेस्ट. कवर एंड कवर टेस्ट में same visually ask the patient to visually fixate a distance target, then we cover the one eye for a moment for 5 seconds, and then rapidly remove that card. So jaise hi aap card ko remove karenge, we will see the movement of the eye jo yahan pe thi eye card ke baad mein, patafat it will move here. That is the cover uncover test. So dono eye mein repeat karna hota hai. To agar cover test mein कोई नॉर्मेलिटी नहीं है, देन वी हैव टू डू कवर एंड कवर टेस्ट, अदरवाइज देयर नो नीड टू डू द कवर एंड कवर टेस्ट. सो देयर आर थ्री टेस्ट आई हैव मेंशनड, कॉर्नियल लाइट रिफ्लेक्स टेस्ट, कवर टेस्ट और कवर अनकवर टेस्ट. सो कमिंग टू अदर एसोसिएटेड न्यूरोलॉजिकल एबनॉर्मेलिटी व्हिच मे बी प्रेजेंट, सेरेब्रल पाल्सी, माइलोमेनिंजोसील, hydrocephalus, craniofacial syndromes, neurofibromatosis, and the seizure disorder. So you have to take the history very cautiously in these patients. And what are the syndromes which may be associated with the strabismus patient? Apert syndrome. So in all these syndromes, you can see one thing is very common, that is the heart disease. So history mein sabse jyada aur examination mein important is focus about the heart disease. Cyanotic spells ki history to nahi hai patient ko. That is important. Apert syndrome ho sakti hai, Down syndrome ho sakti hai, Cryo-Duchenne syndrome, Golden Heart syndrome, Marfan syndrome. So all these you have to take, you have to think in a different way. So when you examine a patient of the strabismus patient. So what are the anesthetic considerations that are important and to be think? So first is the oculocardic reflex, oculorespiratory reflex, post-operative nausea and vomiting, post-conduction testing, and malignant hyperthermia or the Meister spasm. So what is oculocardic reflex? Basically, whenever there is a traction on the muscles or there is a pressure on the globe, so what happens? The impulses or the sensations are carried through long ciliary nerve and the short ciliary nerve to the ciliary ganglion and then to the Gasserian ganglion. And from Gasserian ganglion to the brain stem to the main sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. And from here, sensory nucleus of trigeminal nerve to the motor nucleus of the vagus nerve. And from here, the sensations are carried through the vagus nerve to the heart, and that lead to the depression, the decrease in the contractility of the heart or the bradycardia or any other arrhythmia. Any ventricular arrhythmia can happen. Systole, asyncope, anything can happen. So this is the oculocardic reflex, and this is very important to know. Sometimes you will get a short case, or sometimes examiner is very hamesha pusha chahenge, what is the oculocardic reflex? So you should know that, what is the oculocardic reflex. So what are the triggers of the oculocardic reflex? As we discussed, traction on the extraocular muscle, pressure on the orbital structures, any increase in the intraorbital pressure from an injection or the hematoma, hypoxia, and the hypercarbia. So these are the triggers of the oculocardic reflex, and you have to avoid the things which you can. So what are the basic principles for preventing the OCRs? First thing is the gentle surgical manipulation. Second thing is the depth of anesthesia must be adequate. So aapko depth of anesthesia bhi achhi honi chahiye to prevent the OCR. And other thing is the hypoxia or hypercarbia must be avoided, as it is the trigger of the oculocardic reflex. And another thing is that somebody has mentioned ki atropine or glycopyrrolate bhi de sakte hain to avoid the oculocardic reflex. So atropine 0.02 mg or glycopyrrolate 0.01 mg per kg hum de sakte hain. Lekin what if happens, if it occurs despite all these preventions, so treatment hota hai. Ask the surgeon to stop manipulation. If it doesn't go, then what we do, we give the atropine. But that is a treatment of choice. Agar patient hemodynamics stable ho raha hai, arrhythmias nahi ja rahe hain, then what to do, bradycardia ho raha hai, then give atropine 0.007 mg per kg. This is the treatment of the choice for the oculocardic reflex. What is another thing is the oculorespiratory reflex. Usually to under anesthesia to nahi hota hai the patient, when these surgeries are done under local anesthesia or the regional anesthesia, then it can happen. So what is the oculorespiratory reflex? Reduction in the tidal volume and the respiratory rate. Triggers are same as the oculocardic reflex. It is carried through the long and short ciliary nerves to the ciliary ganglion, and from here to sensory nucleus to fifth nerve. And the efferent limb is the pneumotoxic center in the pons and the medullary respiratory center. So this is the oculorespiratory reflex. So same triggers as for the oculocardic reflex, but what it leads to the reduction in the tidal volume and the respiratory rate. Another thing is the post-operative nausea and vomiting. The incidence of post-operative nausea and vomiting without prophylaxis varies from 37% to 90%. It is also known as the oculoemetic reflex. And what are the predictors for the post-operative nausea and vomiting? If the patient is having, if the patient's age is less than 3 years, duration of surgery is greater than 30 minutes, and the history of the post-operative nausea and vomiting. So these are the fact predictors of the post-operative nausea and vomiting. if the patient is having more than one predictor, it means you have to give him dexamethasone before surgery, starting the surgery, 0.1 to 2 mg per kg, and the ondansetron 0.1 mg per kg before the completion of the surgery. This combination is found to be better. So you have to give there more than one predictor of the present for that. It has also been found that propofol infusion at subhypnotic dose also reduce the incidence of the postoperative nausea and vomiting. Adequate hydration, you have to maintain the adequate hydration. It has been also found that clear fluid 2 to 3 before surgery has also reduced the incidence of the postoperative nausea and vomiting. So keep these things in your mind. Force action testing bhi ek cheez hoti hai ki ophthalmologist may test the range of motion of the extraocular muscle to help distinguish between the paralytical and the mechanical restriction. So it should be avoided as it causes a prolonged deprivation and muscle contraction of the extraocular muscle, which may lead to false conclusion of the force action test. तो क्या होता है कि मूवमेंट ऑफ द मसल मूवमेंट आईबॉल का मूवमेंट चेक करते हैं आप, तो देन अगर आपने पहले से सक्शन कोलिन दी है तो क्या होगा कि वो कॉन्ट्रेक्शन में रहेगा, तो देयर विल बी फॉल्स रिजल्ट्स. सो दैट्स व्हाई इट शुड बी अवॉइडेड सक्शन कोलिन अगर इफ द सर्जन वाज टू द फोर्स फोर्स सक्शन टेस्टिंग ड्यूरिंग द सर्जरी. एनेस्थीसिया टेक्निक स्टैंडर्ड एनेस्थीसिया टेक्निक पिडाजोलाम कैन बी गिवन मॉनिटरिंग ऑल स्टैंडर्ड मॉनिटरिंग इंडक्शन में Fentanyl 1 to 2 microgram per kg, propofol injection. I have mentioned rocuronium because that was it has been found ki rocuronium se hota decrease oculocardial reflex hota hai. Otherwise becquerelinum or etraquinolone can be used safely. RA tube, south pole, flexible LMA, maintenance mein isoflurane, sevoflurane, controlled or spontaneous venting, whatever you wish to use, but avoid the hypoxia and the hypercarbia and maintain the deep anesthesia. IV fluids, iringal lactate. Analgesia mein you have opioids can be used but increases the incidence of the postoperative nausea and vomiting. IV anesthetics or paracetamol use or topical anesthetics can also be used. Regional blocks can be used but in the children there it may be difficult to put that, so that's because of uncooperativeness. So you can use the topical anesthetics very very safely. So these are the ophthalmic drugs which are relevant to the anesthetist. Phenylephrine, alpha 1 agonist. What can done? It can cause myocardial ischemia and the hypertension intraoperatively. So हमेशा जब भी ऐसा नहीं है कि topical दिए तो drug उसके कोई side effects नहीं हो सकते हैं, नहीं हो सकते हैं क्योंकि absorption is intermediate between intravenous and the subcutaneous. तो हमेशा ध्यान रखना है कि ऐसा नहीं है कि अगर कोई हमेशा कि क्या drug patient को चल रही है. टॉपिकल क्या ले रहा है वो, तो फिनाइलेफ्रिन जैसे है तो इट कॉजेज द माइकोडल इशीमिया एंड द इंट्राऑपरेटिव हाइपरटेंशन का कॉज हो सकता है. टिमोलोल अब बीटा ब्लॉकर अल्फा बीटा ब्लॉकर दैन इट कॉज हाइपोटेंशन ब्रेडिकार्डिया एंड ब्रोंकोस्पैज्म. तो अगर अस्थमेटिक पेशेंट है तो यू कैन थिंक ऑफ दैट. पिलोकार्पिन एंड द एस्टिलकोलाइन कोलर्जिक ड्रग्स कॉन्स्ट्रिक्ट द प्यूपिल करते हैं तो इट कैन कॉज ब्रेडिकार्डिया एंड अक्यूट ब्रोंकोस्पैज्म. कार्बोनिक एनहाइड्रेज इनहिबिटर तो reduce the aqueous formation and are used orally or intravenously to treat or prevent the increase the intraocular pressure. So what will do? Renal loss of the bicarbonate and a diuresis depletion of potassium. So pre-op mein aap you can check for the potassium ki kahin potassium to nahi kam hai patient ko. So then icotapid topical anticholinesterase drug. Basically it anticholinesterase the action of the scholin may be prolonged or it has been found ki agar 3 to 7 weeks pehle bhi isko aapne stop kiya then iska persistent effect ho sakta hai, residual effect ho sakta hai and the succinylcholine ka action bhi prolong ho sakta hai for more up to the 30 minutes. So hamesha ye history bhi very important hai agar glaucoma ka patient hai koi, if it is planned for the surgery. What is the nerve supply of the eye? As you know, and all the muscles are supplied by the third nerve except the superior oblique, that's by fourth nerve, and the lateral rectus by the sixth nerve. Regional blocks, sometime examiner may ask you what are the some regional blocks can be given. As I have discussed in the open eye injury, there are three blocks usually given: retrobulbar block, peribulbar block, subtenens block. So what is the advantage of the regional anesthesia? As I discussed, postoperative analgesia, decreased postoperative nausea and vomiting, and quicker discharge. And it provides the echinacea and the anesthesia of the eye. So, hum jo regional blocks maine mention kiye, they usually block the extraocular muscle. But what happens ki facial nerve aapki jo hoti hai spare kar jati hai because it is iske motor innervation is outside the cone. To uske liye humko jo hai facial nerve block alag se karni padti hai, and I will discuss it further. So, retrobulbar block. What is retrobulbar block? Basically, what happen in this? injection is given at the junction of the inferior and the lateral orbit, and using the 30 millimeter of the needle, and as we half pass the equator, direction of the needle should be changed. It should be inwards and the medially. So we are going inside the cone. So this is the retrobulbar block. 3 to 5 ml drug is given in this. So next is a peribulbar block. In the peribulbar block, in this two injections are given basically. One at the junction of the inferior lateral 1/3 and the medial 2/3, and one injection is given as a medial caruncle. So what is the, basically in this we remain outside the cone. So this is the image showing the two difference between the two blocks. Peribulbar block, we are going straight. We are not going inside the muscle cone, but in the retrobulbar block, we are going inside the muscle cone. So the postoperative complication rate is high with the retrobulbar block, and now it is used very rarely. And peribulbar blocks and subtenon blocks are the blocks which are used. So this is the subtenon block. In this, there is a tenon fascia above the eye, above the sclera. So in this, the injection is given below the tenons. So this is on the subtenons block. So the subtenon block used commonly. This method reduces the risk of skin spread, optic nerve damage, and global puncture, but more likely to cause a superficial hemorrhage, and the akinesia, but the immobility may take longer to achieve. So what are the complications of the blocks? Retrobulbar hemorrhage, as we discussed, we are going inside the cone. So bulbar hemorrhage ho sakta hai, proptosis and the subconjunctival ecchymosis ho sakti hai. Globe perforation may be also there. Optic nerve damage, which is more with the retrobulbar blocks, because we are going inside the muscle cone. Intravascular injection, ophthalmic artery may be punctured, and the drug may go retrogradely to the internal carotid artery, and from here to the thalamus and the midbrain, and it can lead to the CNS excitation, the seizures, and the central spread of the local anesthetic can also happen from the optic nerve sheath to the subdural or subarachnoid space. Agar we are near to the optic nerve, ko hum ya to optic nerve damage kar sakte hain. Ab we are optic nerve ke paas sheath hoti hai, nerve hoti hai, dural sheath hoti hai. Agar humne usko pierce kar diya hai, so then subdural or subarachnoid space mein hum ja sakte hain, and it can lead to total brain stenosis and wide symptom, vague symptoms ho sakte hain, aphasia and apnea wagaira bhi ho sakta hai. Then treatment is just supportive treatment. You have to give extraocular muscle malfunction bhi ho sakta hai if the drug is injected inside the muscle. This is the facial nerve block. As we discussed, ki sometimes extra hum log injection dete hain inside peribulbar, retrobulbar, subtenon block. So basically, जो है orbicular oculi muscle spare कर जाती है, so that can lead to the squeezing of the lid eyelid, and that can lead to the problem in the surgery, and can also lead to the rise in the intraocular pressure. So these are the three techniques which are used for the facial nerve block. First is the modified one length block. Second is the O'Brien block, and third is the net button. In the modified one length block, what we do basically at the junction of that lateral orbit, just to lateral 1 centimeter lateral to the lateral wall of the orbit, injection is given. Two injections are given. One is the superior nasal area, and one is the inferior nasal area here. And the O'Brien block, just feel the tragus and anterior to the tragus in the posterior ramus of the mandible layer high here. You have to go inside there and up to the 1 centimeter of the peristium, and as we withdrawn, the drug is given. Up to 3 ml of drug is given. In the Nedbeth-Rehman block, in the injection is given at the we feel the posterior ramus of the mandible and the mastoid process, and between them go inside up to 1.2 centimeter, and as we withdraw the needle, give the up to 3 ml of the injection. But what is the problem is the this block, basically it is very close to the carotid artery or the glossopharyngeal nerve, so that's why it is not used now. So these are the three blocks which are used to block the facial nerve to prevent the squeezing of the eyelid. The topical anesthesia is also used nowadays. 4% lidocaine is used. Advantage is basically to avoid the complication associated with the blocks, rapid physical rehabilitation. Disadvantage is the potential for the eye movement during the surgery. Thank you.